Okay.
I think it's easier.
Okay, clearly Ineke doesn't need an introduction. But anyway, welcome Ineke. Ineke has had a long relationship with us. She's an anthropologist, which will make at least one person more feel more superior. She's trained in Leiden. And she set up gender in Middle Eastern Africa research, Grace Network, in 2005 or so. Which has received a number of awards. So I'm really pleased. She's currently in Macau at the new United Nations University. She's visiting us for the talk conference that you set up. We're very pleased she could take some time off and talk to us about fourth paradigm. Before we start, we are videoing it. I hope that's okay with everybody. And we'll make the videos available. Thank you.
Thank you. I don't think I'm with this now, so. Yeah, so I really appreciate you coming, and I think this is a continuation of the dialogue I have been having with Edwin and Bill from the beginning that we kind of started speaking. And I want to very much continue the dialogue I started with Bill's students. I had a workshop at my house, I think it was 1.5 years ago or something. And I hope you all have pen and paper because I need you to kind of also check a little bit with yourself. Now, why I'm having this frame up is because in the title of my little abstract for you, I mentioned the fourth paradigm. Now, I'm then referring to the three paradigms that are more or less have become currency in the social sciences after Habermas. But other thinkers have made other distinctions, and we're going to go there. So I just quickly want you to take you through this. Although you are computer scientists, many of you are information scientists, the moment you say computer science for development, or ICT for research for development, or information science for development, you're actually entering the field of the human sciences, social sciences. So then the whole thinking about knowledge interests and power becomes very relevant. So just this is, it's not about grasping all this, it's just about that I want you to see the historical reference why I'm speaking about the fourth paradigm. These are the first three. If you want this overview to study at your leisure, I can email it later to Edwin and Bill, and then you all can have it if you want to, okay? So as you can see, there are three paradigms, and I know that, for instance, Chrysanthi Ajuru, the three distinctions she makes in information science research in developing countries, she more or less also uses a distinction of three types of research, which kind of resonates with this distinction, in the sense that I'm talking about it in this work for the book on indigenous and traditional knowledge and technology design, where I kind of juxtapose three different types of research intentionalities with modalities. Because a lot of us think the moment you do research with people, it's always transformatory and emancipatory. That's not necessarily the case. You can do research with people, in the meantime, you can still help them to adapt to reality as it is, without changing it. So this is now specifically for gender, but it could be for any group that has an emancipatory interest. So where I where this kind of thinking is relevant for the work you do is because I'm suggesting that keeping the Habermasian distinction will maybe obfuscate the fact that a lot of participatory computer science research might not be transformational at all. So that's why I had to make this conceptual distinction. But instead of that, so this is why I refer to the fourth paradigm, because I think that many of you are already doing that, but that your praxis is ahead of your theory. And that's what I want to spend this hour with you to kind of figure out whether we can theorize our praxis a little bit better. Because I run against the edges of my box when I started to really reflect on what we had accomplished in the Grace Network. And I realized that we needed new theoretical concepts to explain why our methods work. Because, and that something else was happening, that the accepted categorizations by Habermas or post-Habermasian thinkers or Avjiro's work. I think that what a lot of us are doing is beyond transformation. It's definitely beyond conforming, helping people to conform. It's beyond performatory. I also think it's beyond transformatory. So in order for us to get thinking about that, I want you to kind of have a piece of paper in front of you and make a little circle in the middle. And so very much like a web, circle in the middle, and then like 2, 4, 6 like lines, and also, and then add 6 more circles to those lines. You know what I mean? So you got the circle in the middle, then you get 2, 4, 6 lines, and they end with little circles. So if you think you can do that. I'm not sure whether you can see the mobile phone. I mean, no, that inner circle. Can I? Yeah. So this is it, yeah? And then here also a circle. That's it. Right? So the inner circle, I want you to put intentions, and these are now your intentions as a researcher or as a designer, you know, as a scientist, a scholar, or a practitioner, your intentions. Now, one of the other circles, I want you to put in values. And the other one, methods. And we are going to leave the other ones out because I want you to come up with that. But first, let's look at those three. Values, intentions, and methods. So start with writing in your intention. Like, what is your intention when you do the research you do? And if it's just to get a degree, then be honest, it's for you to get a degree. If it's to kind of make certain groups life better than life, I want to see these people get a better life, or, you know, get more insight or whatever. So what are your intentions? Methods. But let's first focus on intentions. Now this is from Chamber's work. He speaks about adaptive pluralism. Let's not go there yet. I just put it there for me to remind myself that we have to go to the next step. But you focus first on your work, so your intentions. The next step I want you to take, and that is where I remember our discussions in Kabbal about values. I want you to write down what are your personal values. What are the values that you take into the work you do as a scholar? What are your values?
Big example, should we write a big example of the value.
The value. Anything that you consider as a value. Yeah, one of the, so the middle circle is intentions, one of the side circles is values.
Okay.
So after you've done the values, I want you to look at methods. What are your methods? Describe your method. Maybe you have coined the method. Maybe you have tweaked the method, or maybe you're following a accepted method. Or maybe you have many methods. Okay, now you finish that. Okay, now you can put it aside. And now I want you to introduce you to Robert Chalmers' thinking. He is a development research thinker. I think that's the best way to describe him. He experienced in his own career a whole movement from working for, let's say, what is like the World Bank, to more and more advocating a process from the bottom up, participation, you know, farmers first, people first. In his work, you can come in if you want to, why not?
Thanks.
In his working paper for Sussex called Adaptive Pluralism, and you can all have the PDF, you can just download it from the web, he speaks about two different paradigms. One he calls New Newtonian practice, and the other one he calls adaptive pluralism. I find the description problematic. I wouldn't, but you know, he comes from his specific history. But if I look at the two different sets, so take it in as a glance, New Newtonian. And then look at what he calls adaptive pluralism. And you can see that there is validity in this distinction, right? Now, one of the reasons why I find this enlightening is because in one of the discussions I remember from our Chabad workshop was that some of you with your in your research projects, you found a discordance between where you wanted to take your research and what your promoters or your teachers expected. They expected a certain format, a certain mindset, a certain method, a certain methodology. And I remember that they had a discussion about values being equated with emotions, and both being out, because you had to be emotionless, you had to be objective, you know, it had to be standardized, it had to be in a way as much as possible removed from your personal bias as possible. There's of course a big difference between emotions, personal emotions,